Good afternoon, students. Myself, Professor Nisa Susle. In today's lecture of GE 203, that is Principles of Plant Biotechnology, we are going to learn organ culture and different types of other cultures. In last lecture, we have learned callus culture, cell suspension culture, and single cell culture. In continuation with, we are going to learn the next type of cultures, that is organ culture. Now, organ culture is what? Whenever we initiate cultures using any plant organ, entire plant organ, it will be called as an organ culture. For example, plants have root, shoot, leaf, flower as an organ. We culture these organs directly on a liquid media under aseptic controlled condition. Then that type of cultures will be initiated. One by one, we will going to learn each type of culture. So, starting with root culture, the definition of root culture is the culture of excised radical tips of aseptically germinated seedlings or seeds in a liquid or solid medium where they are induced to grow independently under controlled conditions. This type of culture is known as a root culture. That means first, we have to take aseptically germinated seeds. We have to germinate the seeds aseptically in a germ-free environment. Whenever seeds form seedlings, it will develop small roots. So those roots will be, root radicals will be excised, and those radical tips were cultured on a nutrient medium under controlled condition. So this forms the root culture. The principle of root culture is in view plant's roots are not suitable here. Why? Because they are generally are in contact with soil. So generally for this reason we select the we take the roots from aseptically germinated seeds. Now young seedlings are very sensitive to toxic sterilants. That's why the excised radical tips of aseptically germinated seeds are generally used to initiate these kind of culture. Principle is same, aseptically germinated seedling will be taken. The radical tips of almost 5 to 10 mm size will be cut from it. They are cultured on a liquid media containing high auxin, low cytokinin ratio. The cultures were further incubated in dark condition at 25 degrees Celsius for almost 4 to 6 weeks. After 4 to 6 weeks, we have to remove the roots from original plants. Inside laminar airflow, those roots will be cut, trimmed further, and subcultured on a new media bottles or new media flasks, and again they are grown further. So why this kind of root culture is necessary? Main purpose of carrying out the culture is to study the modulation or production of secondary metabolites from roots. So this is the principle of root culture. Now, importance of root culture in relation to basic information. So why we should go for root culture? The in vitro growing of roots will enhance or increase our knowledge about the carbohydrate metabolism in the plants, the role of mineral ions in the plant growth, and also the role of vitamins in the root growth. So we will get the better understanding of all these biochemical factors once we start with the root culture. Root cultures also provided basic information regarding dependence of roots on shoot for growth hormones. Usually the growth hormones are synthesized in the shoots, but later on they are transferred to roots through xylem and phloem. So by culturing the roots, we could be able to understand the phenomena of dependence of roots on shoots for the growth hormone provision. Then root clones are ideally suited for study of the effect of various compounds on root growth. Generally, we have different PGRs invented every year. So all these PGRs or new chemicals, what type of effect they have on the root growth? This kind of study can be conducted once we have a root culture in laboratory. Now, this is the procedure of root culture. So here the target plant is there. Generally, what happens, this is a target plant, aseptically germinated seedling. We have to take it out. Then this aseptically germinated seedling, we will remove the roots from it. Okay, small, small roots. And these were cultured on a either nutrient media or in a petri plate. In some cases, if you want to go for a hairy root culture, we can also go for Agrobacterium rhizogenes strain for hairy root formation. All these cultures were then further kept in a liquid media, submerged hairy roots, or we can in a large scale we can produce or multiply them in a big bioreactors, like wave bioreactor is here, bubble column reactor is there, mist bioreactor is there. So we will provide these bioreactors with necessary media and plant growth hormones, and roots will grow in length and their size, and they will be further harvested. Generally, this kind of root production is done for production of various bio secondary metabolites. So roots generally secrete several metabolites, pharmaceutically important metabolites. For more production of these kinds of metabolites, we can go for medicinal plant roots, root culturing, and this is the process of hairy root culture. Now this is the schematic diagram of how roots grows in the culture. So initially this much length root section have been inoculated into the medium. After 4 weeks it becomes large in size, large in length, and it also gets branched. So what you have to do in a subculturing process, you have to cut it from 2 to 3, you have to give 2 to 3 cuts, then you have to transfer it into new media bottles. Again, they will be grown for 4 weeks and length will be increased, there will be branching. Again, you have to give the cuts, and this procedure is repeated until you get the maximum amount of root mass from this process. So this is called as organogenesis via root organ culture. Now why one should go for root culturing is to actually know the functional analysis of genes involved in nodulation or nitrogen fixation. Also in some cases, if you want to express the foreign proteins in your roots, that means you want to carry out the genetic engineering or transgenesis, the root culture will be a good option to check for the to create the variations in the plant. Also for the production of secondary metabolites, many medicinal plants secrete secondary metabolites through their roots. So if you culture these kinds of roots in a big bioreactors, it will be a good system for getting the continuous supply of these secondary metabolites using those kinds of bioreactors. The culture may produce compounds which is not found in untransformed roots. That means we could create a root culture in which naturally found compounds can be also produced, but also some type of compounds which are not formed naturally, these kinds of compounds can be also created or synthesized using root culture. The culture may change the composition of metabolites, and the culture can be used to regenerate a whole plant also. So all these are the applications of hairy root. So all that is about root culture. Now we will move towards the next organ, that is shoot culture. It is also called as shoot apical meristem culture. So basically the definition of shoot tip culture or meristem tip culture is what? The culture of terminal portion of a shoot comprising mainly meristem, which is situated here and having the size of 0.05 to 0.1 mm, together with the primordial and developing leaves and adjacent stem tissue is known as shoot tip culture. Generally, it contains the small developing primordial leaves and also the meristem along with small tissue of stem. So whenever we culture this portion on a media, that will become a shoot tip culture. Okay, so this is the definition. Principle of shoot tip culture is the excised shoot tips and meristem can be cultured aseptically on a agar solidified simple nutrient media, or in some cases support systems like paper bridges dipping in a liquid media can be also used, and the medium is generally supplemented with the proper concentration of auxin and cytokinin so as the growth can be carried out in a culture. So shoot explants, generally what kind of explants we need to initiate the shoot tip culture? We need shoots. So if you want to produce virus free plants, you can go with this kind of meristem, which is situated at the very apex portion of your plant, surrounded generally by developing leaf primordias. If you one by one you pluck out these leaf primordias, at the end you will find this kind of tissue, which is very delicate and have very small size. You have to observe it under microscope. These are the small developing leaf primordia, and this is a dome like structure containing actively dividing cells. Now this kind of actively growing shoot tips can be also taken. You can also go for collecting the dormant buds for initiating the shoot tip culture. Now the structure of meristem tip culture looks like this. Under the microscope, if you observe it under the microscope, you will find it has a apical meristem. It also has some axillary meristems at both sides. It has tunica corpus tissues here at the center dome tissue, and these are the new leaf primordia developing surrounding the main dome, and these are the actively dividing cells at the tip portion of your plant, and cortex and pith are at the base. So this is the structure of meristem tissue. Generally for meristem culturing we collect this and this portion, but during the shoot tip culture we have to collect the entire portion containing your meristem also, then axillary buds and few developing leaves. So this is all about shoot tip culture. This is a flow diagram illustrating the technique of shoot tip or meristem tip culture. So this is your parent plant, donor plant, also called as mother plant. From mother plant you collect the explant, that is the tip portion. Whenever you collect the explant, you have to surface sterilize it, you have to trim it further so as it contains the meristem tissue. This excised meristem is cultured in a media inside aseptic conditions, you know, inside laminar airflow, and then this meristem starts dividing. It will form new shoots, and after provision with auxin it also forms the root. So generally this is a procedure of micropropagation where using shoot tip and meristems we first go for shoot production. Multiple shoots will be developed and thereafter we will increase the concentration of auxin and we will go for rooting of all those shoots, developed shoots, and in the last stage we produce the complete plantlets with shoot and root, and we harden them inside the greenhouse or poly house. So this is the schematic diagram of meristem tip culture or shoot tip culture. Now why one should go for meristem tip culture is mainly the purpose of going for meristem tip culture is the production of disease free plants. In the meaning of disease free is generally if you can take a virus infected plant and if you take its apex portion, shoot apex and apical meristem using microscope, usually this meristem is free from viruses. The reasons why it is free from viruses is mainly because it has higher endogenous auxin concentration inside it. It has very actively dividing cells within it, and the biochemical activity of these cells is so high that virus cannot multiply in such highly biochemical active cells. So these are the reasons why meristem is generally the first choice of explant for producing the virus-free plants. And examples of plants in which virus-free plants were produced successfully using meristem culture is potato, dianthus, chrysanthemum, gladiolus, sweet potato, and yam. these are few pictures how shoot tip culture or meristem tip culture is further cultured in a laboratory, and how the axillary branching, axillary shooting is being done. These are the pictures of stevia, an important medicinal sweet herb. So this can be also produced using tissue culture. Same like root organ culture, in shoot organ culture also, the organogenesis happens in the same way. That means you first start with a single shoot, which upon incubation at 4 weeks at 25 degree Celsius condition grows into multiple axillary branching. You need to cut every branch after 4 weeks, and you have to transfer it inside laminar airflow into new media bottles. Again, when these new media bottles were cultured further for 4 weeks at 25 degree Celsius and specific photo period is given, they are further divided with numerous branching to each of your shoot transferred to the new media bottle. And then again you can go for cutting these branches and reculturing them on a fresh media bottle. So this continues until several cycles, and finally when you done with all sufficient shoots, you go for root generation, rooting, and then finally the complete plantlet with shoot and root will be developed in vitro. So this is the pathway of organogenesis via shoot organ culture. Now here the reason proposed for escape of meristem from virus invasion is generally because virus is readily moving plant body through the vascular system, which is not there in the meristem. That means meristem does not contain xylem and phloem, which is main entry point for virus. As there is absence of both of these tissue, virus cannot readily move through the meristem tissue. Though it is present in the stem, but it cannot go or invade the meristem. The alternate method of cell-to-cell movement of the viruses through plasmodesmata is rather too slow to keep pace with the actively growing tip. Generally, the plasmodesmatal bridges are there in the cells, but that also are very small in the actively dividing cells of meristem tissue. Then high metabolic activity in the actively dividing meristem cells do not allow the virus multiplication. As the cells were actively dividing in the meristem tissue, they have high biochemical contents in their cytoplasm. So these highly metabolic activity present within those cells will keep the virus away or will stop the virus replication. The virus inactivating system in the plant body has higher activity in the meristem than in any other region of the plant. So it is most active in the apex portion of the plant. And also, lastly, the higher endogenous auxin concentration level in the shoot apex may inhibit the virus multiplication. So all these are the proposed reasons for the escape of meristem from virus invasion. Now, the application of shoot tip or meristem culture is generally used for production of pathogen-free plants, as it doesn't contain any kind of virus or any kind of disease in it. Generally, whatever progeny plants produced using this type of culture will certainly be free from any kind of pathogen. So it is generally used for production of pathogen-free plants. It can be successfully used for micropropagation. That means the production of plants, many multiple plants using meristem tip culture. It is used for storage of genetic resources. For some rare medicinal plants or the plants which are under extinction, under the threat of extinction, we can go for collection of their shoot tips or meristems. We can go for cryogenic preservation of these shoot tips, and whenever we need more number of plants from these stored, preserved shoot tips, we can again take back them from cryopreservation and we can start with the tissue culture process. So this is called as storage of genetic resources, gene banking or tissue banking. To overcome the problem of abortive seeds or non-viable seeds in hybrid plants, generally in hybrid plants the sexual reproduction is not possible because their seeds are generally have the problems like non-viability and abortion. So to overcome these problems, we can go for vegetative propagation of these hybrid plants using their vegetative tissues. Then also for propagation of haploid plants, to create the haploid plants like anther culture, androgenetic plants and gynogenesis. That means ovule culture and anther culture of these haploid plants can be also possible. Then quarantine authority acceptance due to virus free characteristic. Usually being disease free or virus free, these kinds of plants which are produced using shoot tip culture or meristem tip culture have high acceptance at international boundaries because of their virus free characteristic. So all these are the applications of shoot tip or meristem tip culture. Now to continue with further cultures, organ cultures, that are leaf culture and flower culture. First we will see about what is leaf culture. Leaf culture is more simple, common and widely employed technique in tissue culture. It is mainly used for production of ornamental plants, where main objective is to produce the multiple plants. So it produces callus or plantlet very rapidly. Explants were grown in MS media. Leaves are easily available everywhere. So for ornamental plants, we generally collect the leaf explants. They were grown in MS media, Murashni and Scoop media. After a week long incubation, callus formation will start, and whole explant turns into callus after 2 months. Subculturing of callus yielded plantlets. Further culturing of this callus and then organogenesis of callus will yield you complete plantlet or multiple plantlets. This technique was first found by Steves and Sussex, first reported in the leaf cultures of ferns, which is an ornamental plant. So you can take a leaf disc. The wounded leaf disc will start multiplying the cells, and the cells will finally form a callus, undifferentiated proliferative mass of callus. Whenever it is provided with cytokinin and auxin, it will give shoots or roots depending on the concentration of auxin or cytokinin added in the media. So this is the picture of adventitious bud formation. Some species of plants can directly start organogenesis instead of going into callus phase. The leaf itself will start forming adventitious buds. But this phenomena can be observed in only few species, plant species. The application of leaf culture is mainly to study the effects of various nutrients, growth factors and changing environmental conditions on the leaf development. In ferns, to study the formation of sporangia and size at which a primordium is destined to become a leaf. And young leaves of Solanaceae family or Solanaceae species develops tumorous shoots, hence used in the micropropagation studies. So all these are the applications of leaf culture. These are few pictures of commercial production of ferns by tissue culture methodology. So many ornamental varieties of ferns are being produced using tissue culture. These are few pictures of ferns being hardened at polyhouse. Tissue culture fern grown in greenhouse, hexagon fern is there, your normal nephrolepis fern is there. So that's all about leaf culture. Next type of organ culture is flower culture. It is defined as aseptic culture of excised flower pulp on a chemically defined nutrient medium, where they continue their development to produce a full bloom in a culture vessel. Generally, the main purpose of going for a flower culture is to observe its morphological characteristics while opening of the flower. So for that we need an unopened flower bud. And we have to surface sterilize that unopened flower bud in a laboratory, and we have to culture it on a chemically defined nutrient medium, where they usually go for blooming inside glass bottle only. And we can observe the morphological and other processes during the flower development. The principle is it can be cultured at different stages of development. For example, we can take the pre or post pollination stage flower buds in a simple medium. If we take pre-pollination stage flowers, those flowers will only develop the flower. if we take post pollination stage flower parts, then in that case generally the fruit development can be observed in the plants like in which the fruits were generally developing. So protocol is flower buds or mature flowers are collected from the healthy plant. Then they were washed thoroughly and dipped into 5% Teapol solution for 10 minutes and washed. Teapol is generally used to clear out all the dirt and it's a surface sterilizing agent. Then these buds were transferred into laminar airflow cabinet and further surface sterilized using 5% of sodium hypochlorite for 2 to 3 minutes and then finally washed with double distilled water. Using the flame forceps and scalpel, the flower bud or the mature flower is transferred into the nutrient media culture tubes containing 20 ml of solid media. Now this after inoculation of the bud inside the test tube, these test tubes were closed and then they were incubated at 25 degrees Celsius with 16 hours of light provision and 8 hours of dark dark condition in the incubation. Now why one should go for flower culture is mainly because to study the fundamental studies of development of flower. Also, in if you are taking the flower after post pollination stage, then you can also observe the fruit development within the test tubes. The culture of pollinated flower is very important to study the fruit development. In vitro fruits are smaller than their natural counterparts, but the size can be increased by supplementing the media. And mainly for floral morphogenesis studies, that means after pollination, in how many hours the flower starts opening, petal starts opening, and after how many hours the flower becomes or flower starts becoming the fruit, etc. These kinds of studies can be easily observed inside a glass in vitro, and that's why culturing the flower is very much important to carry out these kinds of studies in the laboratory. Now next type of culture is ovary or ovule culture. This is the part of a flower. Ovule culture is present, or ovules are present in the ovary. So either you can take the entire ovary, or you can also go for collecting the ovules from the ovary and you can culture them on a defined nutrient medium under controlled conditions. So generally ovule culture is an elegant experimental system by which ovules are aseptically isolated from the ovary and are grown aseptically on a chemically defined nutrient medium under controlled conditions. The principle is isolation of ovary containing egg cell. After fertilization, single zygote formation leads to embryo processing shoot and root primordia. So generally we collect the ovules after fertilization, and these ovules or entire ovary can be also cultivated on a cultured on a nutrient media. So here the ovary of Lycopersicum esculentum on an artificial medium is shown. So just excised flower is cultured in the A bottle. B is the culture of excised ovary. You can remove all the petals from the flower and you can just keep the excised ovary. You can also go for ovule also. Again further dissect the ovary and collect out the ovules and culture them on a nutrient medium. So this is the picture of in vitro grown tomato inside the from flower from ovary. So generally mainly main purpose of ovary culture or ovule culture is to study the fruit development. Like you can go for ovule culture, you can also go for ovary culture. And J.P. Nish was the scientist who first experimented with the ovaries of Phaseolus vulgaris, Cucumins hunguria, Fragaria chilensis and Fragaria virginiana, and also Lycopersicum esculentum. Ovaries excised several days after pollination showed satisfactory growth on a simple medium. So gynogenesis, the ovary culture sometimes also called as gynogenesis, the ovary or ovule being the female reproductive part of a flower, it's being called as a gynogenesis. Genesis means generation, regeneration, or gyno means female reproductive part. So gynogenesis is the culture of unfertilized female gametophytes, that is ovules and ovaries. Generally in this case we go for unfertilized non-pollinated female gametophytes. This method is used when plants do not respond to androgenic methods. There is a problem with regenerating albino plants from anther culture, or the donor plants are male sterile. So in that kind of case we go for creating the female haploid plants using gynogenesis approach. Now gynogenesis is usually less efficient than the androgenesis, used in plant families that do not respond to androgenesis, like Liliaceae and composite family. The procedure is, we have to first select the healthy parent plant, mother plant. We have to check the ovule or ovary development stage by histology, by histologically dissecting the flower parts and ovary part. If they are at the proper stage, then we can go for collection of other flower buds or ovaries or ovules from the same plant. We have to select the appropriate flower bud and we have to surface sterilize it using chemicals like TPOL, sodium hypochlorite, calcium hypochlorite, double distilled water. And then we have to inoculate this ovary or ovule after surface sterilization inside laminar enclosure on a suitable nutrient medium. Then the cultured ovary or ovule have to be incubated in the culture room, growth room, at 25 degrees Celsius with 16 hours of light and 8 hours of dark condition. Then it will either lead to regeneration of callus or an embryo, and finally you will get the haploid plant from such callus or embryo. So this is the procedure of producing the female haploid plant, as we are collecting the unfertilized female gametophytes. That means it has a chromosome number N. That's why the final chromosome numbers in the progeny generated using the same procedure will be also N, being the haploid plant. So in this picture, the gynogenesis of Spathiphyllum wallacei, which is an ornamental plant, is shown. The ovary of is collected, which is unfertilized, and ovary or ovule, they were cultured on a nutrient media, and finally you can regenerate the plants. Now, what is the importance of ovary or ovule culture? Is mainly to carry out the test tube pollination and fertilization. So it is also called as in vitro pollination and in vitro fertilization. To study these processes in plant tissue culture, we can go for carrying out the ovary or ovule culture. It also has applications in hybridization program. The plants which cannot be naturally hybridized can be hybridized using artificial pollination in the tissue culture. So unfertilized ovary or ovules will be taken, and the pollens from another plant can be used for hybridizing the ovary or ovules. Now next importance is production of haploid callus through ovule culture. You can regenerate the callus, and the further plants developed from this callus will be haploid plants. Generally ovule culture is carried out in orchid plants, floriculture plants. Induction of polyembryo by ovule culture is also possible. If we treat your ovules or ovary with certain chromosome doubling mutagenic agents, the polyembryony may be observed within the ovules. And virus free, it's a kind of virus free culture. That means you can also produce the plants which are virus free in nature using ovule or ovary culture. So that's for today's lecture. We have three more cultures remaining, that is anther or pollen culture, embryo culture, and protoplast culture. That we will learn in the next lecture. Thank you very much.